Hello, it's Benji Galayan, surgeon here, and this is part two of my video of analyzing my bullet games in chess.com. So, as you see in the first game, I lost, so this is my second game with the same player. I believe his name is, I don't know if I can pronounce it, Kion Nayasar. Okay, so right now, I was black on the first game, so I was. I am playing white now, so I actually played the London system before, and my opponent played d6, going to the standard position, and as you see, knight e7 was played. I go into the standard line of the London. Now here is a very interesting move, queen d6. It takes advantage of white's only weakness in this position, the b2 pawn, because we have we have moved the bishop out of the pawn chain, so the natural protection on the pawn on b2 is gone. So he tries to attack it. So what I did is I moved it up so it would be defended, and what I plan to do now is to push this pawn here and then here. So I would follow up with a3 and b4, forming this chain. So it would be stronger, and I would gain space on the queen side, and I will start a pawn storm there. So let's see how black can get. Knight e4, taking advantage of the weakness of this square. And probably if I play this move, it would go here and capture this bishop. So what I did is I played c4, which he captured to prevent the expansion with c5. Bishop takes, and now he played knight e2f6. Now here I think I created a serious error here. Not an error, but an inaccuracy. Here I played knight fd2, offering an exchange. Where in fact I should play a different move, maybe knight e5, because this move put into question, or makes this move possible, f3, okay? Now it attacks this knight, and as you can see, the knight has to retreat. He cannot go here, here, and here, and here. So almost all of his moving squares are covered, so he can only move here on d6 square. So it should have been a good position for me, since I will gain a tempo. This is called a tempo move class, okay? A tempo move is moves that forces your opponent to retreat or give you a free move. So this tempo moves are usually strong, because it makes your army go forward and your opponent's army retreat or fall back. So find this move in your game, and certainly your game will improve. So let's go back to my intended game. So from here, I played knight d2 f2. He played knight d6, and here of course I want to preserve this bishop, so I drop it back on d3. Now I can actually put a knight there and exchange it for this knight. But instead, after bishop d7, I decided to develop, but then I overlooked this possible move, knight d5. This is a very strong move, since it forces white to exchange this knight. As you can see, the knight is attacking both my knight and my bishop. One technique that I can share to you guys is that if your opponent moves, focus on his last move and ask yourself, what is he threatening? Always focus on CCC, guys, check, capture, and threats. So here, the threat is a fork on c3 and on f4, so I'm forced to capture. And he decided to open the c file. Here, I'm not against it, but actually, I think better is e6 c5. Because this one frees the bishop, it makes it possible for him to exchange bishops here, because here this bishop is considered bad because of the pawns are on the same color as the bishop, like this. So it's kind of obstructing the movement of the bishop. Usually it's a good policy to trade bad bishops to good bishops. Here white's bishop is good, since the pawn center pawns are not obstructing this movement, unlike this d7 bishop. But anyway, what was played was c takes d5, and after that move, queen to e2, creating battery here. on this file and also prepares to put my rook, my other rook c7, since this rook does not have immediate action here. Also, take note of this game step, this game line. If you see an open file, you need to envision your rooks to control it by creating a double rook, or what we call a battery here. So if your rooks can go to a battery and control this file, then your position will be stronger. So bishop e7, preparing the castle. I was the first one to put a rook there. And then I played knight to f3. Okay. Also, think of ways to improve the position of your pieces. A simple comparison of minor pieces can help you. Like, for instance, dark square bishop, you try to compare them. Okay, you have a white has a better dark square bishop. Compare this bishop, white has a better light square bishop. And now, since last move my knight is here, somehow this knight is actually doing a better job than this knight, because this knight supports a possible bishop b5, exchanging dark square bishop. I mean, my light square bishop, his bad bishop versus my good bishop. So I need to improve the position of my knight, which I did by playing knight to f3. This knight plans to go to e5 and, you know, attack this bishop and puts the knight in a better position. So he tried to contest the file, which is a very good move, since it kind of neutralize or balance the powers on the open file. So I played knight to e5, and obviously he played bishop to d5. And here I'm thinking whether should I play Qh5 now or after the exchange from b5. I was like thinking of ways of maybe if I can, you know, trick black into recapturing with a knight. So after queen to h5, I'm threatening both the h7 and the f7, not thinking that I need to do a bishop exchange first before I be able to jump my queen here. So I tried to do that and capture with a queen and queen to h5. Here he played the natural g6 move, but actually I believe better was h6. Maybe not, because I have a possibility of a sack here, possible sack on the h6 square. So maybe he's trying to avoid that possibility. However, the actual g6 creates weak squares, okay, or holes in your base. So when you're moving pawns, guys, think of the possibility of creating a hole, or what they call this, a square weakness on your base, especially around your king. Because if you create holes, patterns might show up or occur, and this will let your opponent plan how to attack your king or how to invade or infiltrate your base. So think twice when you're pushing a pawn. So here, g6 was played, and I played queen to h6. I think a better move would be retreat my queen back here to b1, and, you know, kind of neutralize rooks first before going back to the king side. But anyway, I played queen to h6. He played knight to f5. Here, I think a better move is to exchange rook first, and then after exchanging rooks, then perhaps that's the only time that we play rook c8, and then, you know, try to you know, make this queen capitalize on white's background weakness. The king here is kind of, you know, losing some support, and a possibility of checkmate on the background might occur. So, but instead, knight f5 was played, so I played queen to h3, and he immediately played queen to e2, judging the fact that I might, you know, lose on the background. So I played g4, a very brave move, but actually I think this creates more weakness. Let's say, for instance, the knight goes here, this square is weak, or perhaps going back here, and then going back here, and then jumping here would create some possibilities of taking advantage of the f2 weakness. basing on the attack of the king and the knight on e4. So anyway, but he had changed rooks, trying to, you know, follow the theme of background weakness. However, after exchanging rooks, he overlooked that I will be able to also attack his 7th rank. So I played rook c7, creating a pig on the 7th rank. A pig is a term to use when a rook invades the 7th rank or the 2nd rank of his opponent, and the rook will do lots and lots of damage there. It's called a pig because usually when the rook reaches that square, he would be able to capture a lot of pawns or even pieces at times. So here, bishop d6 was played, rook took to f7. Now, note that he cannot capture the knight here, since I have a threat here with king 6, h7, mate. So, he played knight g7, interposing, and then I decided to sacrifice my rook here. The reason being is that since back rank weakness will, eventually gets a toll on me, I decided to attack. In bullet games, sacrifices, follow-up, followed by tempo attacking moves, with threats is often strong. Since your opponent doesn't have time to think, attacking moves would really be a good plan on winning, since if he creates an accuracy or if he creates mistakes, then he would eventually lose. So after king takes rook, king e6, king g8, knight 6g6. Now, white has some kind of initiative here, since after pawn takes, queen takes, there's a possibility that I can checkmate black. Let's say for instance he plays here, I might be able to pull off an attack here by maybe capturing this first and then threatening bishop e5. So instead of capturing my knight, he played queen to d1. Check. He captured on f1st, my bishop on f1st, and after knight f4, he played queen d1. So I don't have any choice but to move up. After takes, I went back. I will try to escape on this route. Sorry. I will try to escape using this route. However, he strangely played rook e8, protecting his weakness on e6. However, I tried to, create a plan involving my knight maneuvering in this square by knight a5 and knight f6. And this lets me target three pieces, the king, the rook, and the queen. So maybe he overlooked it. So after knight f6, he immediately played king d6. Well, in fact, it's a major mistake. I think a better move was king d1, king g2, king g4, probably upper tempo. But because knight g3 doesn't look real good, since that would allow black to maybe play rook f8 and, kind of hold things together, threat this queen f3, and then capture here. So I have nothing better but to, let black do a perpetual on me and save this game. However, queen g6 is after knight f5, king g6 is played, and after knight f6 was able to transpose into an endgame where I am a pawn up. So if you count black has 5 pawns, I have 6 pawns. And you might think the win is easy, but it's far from it. It's after f4, okay? One technique that you can also do when you're a pawn up is to use your pawns to restrict the possibilities or pawn advances from your opponent. So this move do two things. It prevents a possible e5 in the future and g5. Now followed by a king's invasion, maybe by marching towards the pawn. So king f7, king g2, king f6, king d3, king f5. Now it's important for white to control this move, because if you will allow the king here, and then this pawn will, really be in danger. So we play d5, and here I created an accuracy. I think a better response here is maybe to play h3, saving a tempo, since anytime I can play h4. And if let's say I play h3, if black plays d5, I would then be able to play takes, and then e4. Probably this is winning for white, since let's say for instance, Black decides to get a pawn or go march and, you know, march towards here, and even though Black will be able to take that, I will be able to create a quitting pawn in my g pawn and march it towards the board. So he didn't do that. Instead, after b5, I played d4, and then he tried to. Now I played h4. We tried to use up the tempo on the king side. Now here, I tried to invade movement, but then after king d7, he's holding the position quite well. So maybe a possible move here was to. Here I tried to play h3. I used my tempo to already. Maybe I could have played h5, hoping for a possible tempo here. And after here, that's the only thing that I played h3. Now if he goes here, this f6 square will be invaded. So if he goes here, then this square would be taken against him. I don't think that this one is a good one. Maybe if he plays king f7, f5 is a good move. Because after, let's say king f7, and I played this error, then he goes to the pawn first. The pawn first, and perhaps create his on pass pawn. So instead of that, I could have played f5, and after takes, then I would be able to capture this pawn. But anyway, it's really easy for me since I'm a pawn out. So let's go back to a3, see how I actually do it. Okay, so that's what I did. And then here, I find it difficult to, you know, outmaneuver the king, because I'm trying to outflank the king without giving him the possibility to, you know, attack this pawn. Okay, so what I did was I tried to do some backward moves. Okay, I think here he created an inaccuracy. He should have played king of five, but I would still win. Because after, let's say here, I can play here, which the position transposes to what I played in the actual game. So king d6, king d4, king f6, and here now I decided to go to g4 England, which wins on the spot. The rest would be easy since I'll be able to play this fast one. So king f6, 6, king d4, okay. As you can see, it's now easy for me. I'm just trying to, okay. Now this is a very important concept. I'm sacrificing a pawn here so that my king could gain entry to this square, and this pawn will be unstoppable. Okay, this pawn will simply king after my king goes to e7. So look here what happens. Okay, and I win. And actually, I made him after a few moves. Here it's funny because my opponent thought that he would be able to do a stalemate same on me, but since he has pawns, which I did not capture, he realized that the chances of doing a stalemate on me is next to impossible. So that's it, guys. Thank you for listening, and I hope you learn a lot from this game. You can, you know, like my video on YouTube and subscribe to my channel to watch my other videos. Goodbye guys, and see you on my next.